Hemophilia A is a rare bleeding disorder that occurs when a specific protein in the body is missing or doesn't work as it should, and the blood can't clot properly. The traditional approach to treatment has been to replace the missing protein with the same protein made in a lab, called replacement factor. But hemophilia research is evolving rapidly, and scientists are working to develop new ways to treat the disease. I'm Galia Levy, Associate Group Medical Director at Genentech, and I've spent much of my career working on coagulation disorders like hemophilia. Let me explain why I'm so excited about what's new in this field. You may not know that bleeds come in different forms. Some are the result of minor injuries like bumps or falls, and some are spontaneous, meaning they happen without an obvious cause. Most of these bleeds can be easily detected. However, there's another type of bleed that is so small it goes unnoticed. These microbleeds occur in capillaries, blood vessels even smaller than our arteries and veins. Microbleeds happen in all of us, as even regular body movements like walking or standing up can cause them. For people with hemophilia A, when a bleed occurs, the bleeding doesn't stop as easily. So any bleeds, even if they are invisible, can lead to long-term problems over time, like irreversible joint damage. That's why the recommended approach to treating hemophilia A is to try to prevent bleeds from happening in the first place with prophylactic treatment. But prophylactic treatment can require frequent intravenous infusions, anywhere from every other day to every 5 days, and people can still experience bleeds. This may lead people with this disease to adapt their daily routines in order to avoid bleeds and accommodate treatment. Researchers are investigating ways to continue to advance hemophilia care and discover new treatment options that can offer more consistent protection against bleeds. It would mean so much to people with hemophilia and their families if they didn't have to constantly worry about when their next bleed might happen, and I'm very hopeful that we can reach this goal in the future. Another exciting development in the field of hemophilia research is the innovative way treatments are being tested in clinical trials. For example, we can gather real-world data from people before they begin a traditional clinical trial. One way to do this is through non-interventional studies, which may help us understand how patients are being treated in the real world. This can help us capture new types of information from clinical trials, which could be incredibly valuable for hemophilia research. For example, most trials compare data between different groups, which has been and will continue to be essential to developing new treatment options. But non-interventional studies allow us to look at clinical data in a different way, through what's called intrapatient comparison. This compares the impact of treatments on a truly individual level. Data gathered before the person enters a conventional clinical trial shows how they responded to their previous treatment, and that can be directly compared to their response to a new therapy in the clinical trial. For some diseases, like hemophilia, this approach could help reduce the variability associated with comparing the impact of treatment in different patients, such as disease biology, lifestyle, and other factors that could be influencing treatment responses. The landscape of hemophilia is changing rapidly, and I'm excited to see so much progress in new types of research, treatments, and ways of capturing the patient experience. Ultimately, this hard work will help doctors and people living with hemophilia make more informed decisions about their care.